Vince, who is currently trying to not mess up the length of the mic for the speakers after me.
You're doing a good job.
I'm trying. It's very weird when the mic's down here. I am the Associate Director of Artistic Engagement at the California Shakespeare Theater. I also go by they and them pronouns, and I'll be co-facilitating some stuff. You might even see me later in some other things in the afternoon, so we'll see. So.
Yes. So we have little sort of house announcements and a welcome for you all, and then we'll get into things. To kick it off, I wanted just to give some context for why we're doing this event and, you know, what sort of led us to this place. And really, you know, Lisa and I only met like a year ago.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah. And two people who identify on sort of a trans spectrum. Mm-hmm. And then we sort of met in a couple other spaces and realized that there was a huge lack of knowledge around sort of trans-related identity issues and sort of gender analysis in general in our field, even in spaces that we were in that were like, coming from a social justice base. And so there have also been a few productions around the country this year that have really, there have been productions of plays with trans characters or by trans playwrights that theaters, very well-intentioned theaters, have put on and then have received like a lot of call-outs from community for not doing it right and all of that. And sort of within that context, we realized that we were in a place to really like give people resources and to also strategize and whatnot. So the goals for today are to provide context and dialogue on this issue from multiple perspectives in our field. Feel free to take a seat, you're welcome here. To provide resources and support for everyone in the room to make intentional trans-inclusive work and trans-centric work. And then to showcase some trans-identified theater artists, specifically playwrights of color. Those are our thoughts for today.
Word. And so if you want to take a look in your handy dandy packet, so this is an agenda for the day, information on the playwrights, and there's also a resource guide. So we do want to name that we're not necessarily going to be going over terminology. Really, we want to be thinking about how do we use the off with a panel with some lovely, lovely panelists. Right there. I'm classy, everybody. Then we'll be going into breakout sessions. We actually decided to do breakouts by identity, really to have an opportunity for trans-identified folks and folks that are on the trans spectrum to talk about what they feel like is missing or barriers or a lack of like strategic efforts within theater to be more inclusive. And on the flip side, having an opportunity for theater administrators, for independent artists who don't identify as transgender, to talk about what barriers that they see and what are some ways that we can brainstorm out institutional solutions. So we'll be coming from both a programmatic and an organizational practices perspective during that session. And because the whole saying of what's learned here leaves here, we want to have an opportunity where everybody actually gets to hear what's been brainstormed. So after that, we'll be coming back for about 30 to 40 minutes and doing a share out so that everybody can hear about the different things that were spoken of in both groups. We'll have a brief reception, we'll have food. I'm really excited. I'm a really big fan of fancy cheeses, and we're gonna have fancy cheeses. And then we'll go into the staged readings and getting to hear some of the amazing work from the playwrights that we'll be featuring today.
Yeah, so some general logistics. We are being live streamed through HowlRound at the moment.
Can everybody cheer for the live stream?
Hey! We're using the hashtag #BreakingTheBinary2016. If you have thoughts that you'd like to communicate via, you know, social media, please use that hashtag. Mm-hmm. Bathrooms. There is one all-gender bathroom just right outside of this door, and then there's another bank of maybe like six, you know, two doors with multiple stalls out to the right, and then take another right sort of down the hall. Those are also all-gender bathrooms for folks. There's the exit, if anything should happen. I'm not laughing to this mic. Let's see if there's anything else. Yeah, and just to like reiterate that like everyone in this room right now, there's a wide range of folks, you know, folks who maybe identify somewhere on a trans spectrum as a theater professional, as not, and then some folks who maybe have no relationship. This is their start, the start of their relationship to sort of trans spectrum identity, you know, language in general. Mm-hmm. And just want to say that everyone is welcome here, and would love for folks who, just to reiterate, you know, we're not there. We're trying to provide as many resources as we can for mm-hmm. folks to do, you know, the work on their own. We would love to be able to explain everything and just can't get there, but we want to make sure everyone feels supported and knows that they're welcome. And folks who maybe don't identify, you know, on a trans spectrum, like, listening is a powerful thing, right? Mm-hmm. Listening with your heart open and, you know, staying that way throughout the day. We are so glad that you're here. That's all I got.
Right on. So just, we want to go through, and we'll go over these in the breakout sessions as well, but just kind of having like working agreements for the day so that everybody can show up and be as present in the space as possible. So a couple of ones we work with is kind of reiterating what SK had said, is some of the best ways to show up in allyship for identities that are not your own is to listen and to hold space and just witness. And then, but we also want you to participate. So that's why we're having the sessions where we're gonna talk and strategize and brainstorm and figure out how to change the world. It's gonna be magical. a really big thing as well is not assuming people's pronouns. So if you don't know, ask. An example that my co-facilitator for our later session and I talked about is if you hear somebody say something amazing and you're like, yes, this gave me my whole life, and you want to reference it and you don't know their name and you don't know their pronoun, a really great way might to be like, so I really liked that thing that you said. Could you remind me of your name and your pronoun, please?
Oh my God, thank you.
Okay.
It's SK.
Okay.
They, them.
Word. So I really like what SK is wearing right now. I think that turtleneck is just absolutely fabulous.
Okay.
So, example. So really just wanting to ask and not make these assumptions. Within that, we're also asking that if you are corrected on pronouns or if there's a term that somebody brings up like, hey, that actually feels kind of funky, being able to listen and not taking things personally and being able to witness. So that skill set again. We also want to encourage that feeling challenged or like if you're confused is not really an excuse to disengage. As to SK's point earlier, we do want this to be a space where everybody feels welcomed and feel like you have learning questions. But on that note, if you're really just having a moment, like if something happens and you're like, I need to take a breather, please take care of your needs. If you want to talk about something, both myself, and then I'm also gonna, at the back of the room, it's Tears of Tyler with Cal Shakes. So if you need a second to tap out and talk to somebody, you can approach either one of us during sessions, during this first panel session, and we will come out and we will talk with you and we will be your cheerleader and it'll be great. Or we'll be listening and witnessing and all that jazz. Yeah, I think that's all I got. In addition, we also just wanna do we want to thank Cal Shakes. We want to thank the Irvine Foundation New California Arts Fund, which has provided a lot of the resources to pay to bring some amazing artists here to value our performers by paying them. The Theater Communications Group for handling our live, for like really promoting and spreading the word, and HowlRound for the live stream and for reaching out to us to share this information with a broader network. And that's all I got.
Yeah, and I just want to say that both folks from Berkeley Rep and from Cal Shakes have supported us in all these really beautiful and mm-hmm. unexpected ways. So just want to really offer a deep thanks to like the staff that are here right now and are not here right now. We've experienced a lot of community support, and we're super grateful for that.
Cool. I'm going to put a mic down and go away now.
Great. We're going to start the opening panel. Thank you so much, everyone. Great. So, hi. this is sort of the first part of our programming. We're going to try to keep with the time schedule that we have, even though we're starting a little late. I would love to just go down the line and have everyone say their names and pronouns, and then I'll read a short bio for folks and kick off the panel, if that's cool. So we'll start with you. Yeah.
All right. Can everyone hear me okay? Excellent. So bonjour, anin is yayin gijigin dijnakaz waswaganin and doing japan makizin and do dem nij manituag. My name's Ty. I'm from the Oneida and the Ojibwe tribes. I use he, his, him pronouns for political reasons, but I identify as Two-Spirit, or Nish Manitowoc.
Hi, I'm Manish, and I please use they and them if you're talking about me behind my back.
Hi, I'm Schaefer, and I use he and him.
Hi, I'm Nick, and I use they and them pronouns.
Beautiful. So I'm just going to take a minute to give some bios for these folks. So Ty Defoe is, as he mentioned, from the Oneida and Ojibwe tribes of Wisconsin. He is a Two-Spirit trans activist, cultural pioneer, writer, musician, and is known for his cultural education and hoop and eagle dancing. He is also a core facilitator with Art Equity and has been in fellowship with TCG focusing on equity, inclusion, and diversity. That is Ty. Manish is a comedian, life coach to the burned out activists. Hello. Program coordinator at Queer Cultural Center, home of the National Queer Arts Festival, and the founding artistic director of Peacock Rebellion, a social justice arts organization for queer and trans people of color. This is Manish. Next down the line, we've got Schaefer, who is a senior grants manager at the Exploratorium, where he serves as a strategic lead for the Museum's Center for Art and Inquiry, Environmental Initiative, and Science and Society programs. Before joining the Exploratorium, he held the position of Director of Institutional Giving and Strategy at ACT, American Conservatory Theater, where he led foundation government and corporate fundraising for annual productions and programs, as well as the strategic development of special initiatives. This is Schaefer. And then we have Nick Kay, who is a performance artist whose work involves sculpture, video, sound, installation, collage, and printmaking. Nick's current transdisciplinary projects explore movement as a place of reclamation of the body, history, and identity. Born and raised in the Bronx, New York, Nick graduated from Professional Performing Arts School in 2007 and was a Hemispheric Institute Emergence Fellow in 2009. They're a founding member of Third Language Queer Arts Collective. In 2015, Nick premiered their solo performance, Lil Black, in Chicago at Lynx Hall, and they recently developed a web series called Bronx Cunt Tour around their solo performance of Lil Black for Open TV, which premieres in spring 2016. If you could give our panelists a lovely round of applause, I would appreciate it. Great, so we're gonna kick it off. I wanna name that Lisa and I really curated these panelists pretty intentionally. We wanted folks coming from many different perspectives within the theater field and the arts field, and we're super grateful that everyone is able to be here and have this conversation. To open it up, I asked them ahead of time to, I'm just gonna give each person like about 5 minutes to name a successful experience as well as a main barrier or challenge from your perspective on navigating theater. Creating trans-centric or trans-inclusive artistic work. So you can take it from a personal point of view or more of a, strategy point of view as well, and everything that comes in between. So I'm gonna ask Ty to kick us off.
Should we start at the other end?
Oh, we can start at the other end. Great. I'm going to ask Nikkei to kick us off.
Okay, so to reiterate the question,
yes.
You want us to name a successful experience and a challenge.
Yes.
Navigating our transness in theater and performance spaces.
Correct.
I would say, you know, not to be the contrarian, but I feel like I have an issue with identifying when I'm experiencing challenges because of my gender or when I'm experiencing challenges because I'm Black or whatever, you know what I mean? So in a lot of situations, I am very often like, is this a racial thing? Is this a gender thing? Is this a sexuality thing? I'm not exactly sure, but whether it is one of those three things, it's usually like, this place has a problem and they need to work it out. So I just like to start with that, you know, like it doesn't matter. Let's start on a great success. I would say that in working, well, this, okay, I'm just going to say, this past fall, I premiered a solo performance that I've been working on for a while, and I come from a theater background, so I was thinking about many different ways I could perform, also in theaters, but also in galleries and stages, more so about the audience, not the venue or the container, right? I'm like, who do I want to see this space? So spaces to perform wasn't really the thing, but I worked with an organization called Chances Dances that promotes parties, but also was doing a retrospective, and they were thinking really expansively with a group of curators around Chicago about how to take performance artists and other types of artists and work with venues in Chicago to show work that they had funded through their 10-year career. And I had received a $1,000 grant from them 2 years ago to develop this performance, so I was really excited about performing. And with the curators, I was able to perform thinking about the content of the show. So the content of the show is very much so about me growing up as a little black girl and dealing with sort of society's ideas of my sexuality and how I should show my feminine body in ways that I've discovered to find power in my femininity through transitioning in various different ways. So doing that, it's like, what spaces would be really good to show small clips of that, right? And with the curators who really believed in the story and in me and finding secure, safe spaces, I was able to perform on a party bus, which was really random, right? But it was really great in terms of engaging with the audience and having agency and being able to create a healthy, very small moment, right, where I share that story in a little clip. I was also able to perform in a gallery space that normally I don't really feel very good or very safe in, sort of white fluorescent boxes, you know? But there was something about the way that, once again, this organization worked with the gallery to create an installation for the performance. So they created a stage, they thought about lighting. I felt that I was affirmed and that my differentness and otherness, either on that party bus or in that gallery space that I've never seen work like that before in, affirmed me instead of making me feel kind of like an outsider. Also administratively, I felt like I was able to circumvent the name situation that happens with what's your professional name versus what is your birth name and getting paid. There was, you know, some things that you can't avoid when dealing with universities, but for the most part, that was one of the most successful experiences. And to tell you the truth, the challenges, there's a litany. So I would like not to focus on that so much, but I would say that one of the biggest challenges that persists is the difference between working with really great, affirming program directors or curators who really see me and see my work, but then administratively, the accountant hasn't gotten a talk, right? So then they're like, oh, Nicole, we would love to get your W-9 form and your Social Security. And it's like, no, actually, there's nowhere in any of my correspondences with you that I ever used my government name. And I would really appreciate if we can, like, create a boundary between that. And I think that is a sort of sensitivity that people who aren't working in programming may not have had talks about, right, with folks who are doing more of the specific curation.
Yes, great. Thank you.
So I... comedy and created my own work. My current role in theater and in arts in general right now is a more administrative role, and has been for quite some time. So I'm coming from the perspective of a trans person in administration, particularly fundraising, which is, I have to say, it's a, I'll tell you a success, but I have to say that fundraising as a field is not very diverse, regardless of whether you fit conventional categories in society. So there's a particular challenge to being a gender non-conforming and trans person when money's at stake. At least I feel that there has been. Not necessarily by it's not necessarily an institutional edict, but there's a level of I'm supposed to make these people as comfortable as possible, so they give my organization money. And that is a baseline of how you operate as a fundraiser. And when you are confusing or have a conflicting identity that people don't understand, causes a lot of anxiety, which has determined some of my trajectory as a fundraiser. Like, I do grant writing and institutional fundraising because it involves less one-on-one schmoozing with individual people that have to understand me in that way. Mm-hmm. But there's those challenges I'll talk about there. But I want to speak to a really positive side of being a senior leader at one of the country's largest regional theaters. Because when I was at ACT, I was on the senior team, and that's a very elite, discreet, select group of people that helps set strategy for all sorts of programming and policies at the institution. My theater leadership was not always so, I don't think they always comprehended and understood, but when I decided to transition fully and spoke to our executive director at the time, and saying, I'm concerned that I'll be putting donors off, so I want to know how you want me to handle donors. How do we want to roll out this discussion? And I have to say, her answer was, well, I don't care about how they feel. How do you feel? How do you want to handle this, the rollout of this decision? So I believe that people didn't have a lot of experience with trans people in my particular theater, because I know theater has a, as we all know, a reputation for being diverse, but that is a very limited diversity. It does not actually embrace the complexities of diversity. The initial response, even when the leadership did not understand what it was that needed to happen, was we support you, and want to make this happen. That is, in a way that acknowledges your work and your worth, and not make you uncomfortable. So that doesn't always roll out that way, but the intention was, it meant everything to me. So I do feel also that, having worked in other industries after theater, I work in a museum setting now. The arts have, like I said, the arts have a reputation for experiencing diversity more fully. I do think that that's true in some contexts, but not in others, and we do need to keep pushing the conversation and talking about the complexity and intersectionalities of diversity. So I guess that's for now.
Thank you. Great. Again, space afterwards to discuss. So we're just going to move along the line. And Manish, go ahead whenever you're ready.
Oh my God, so many things. Okay, so okay. Okay, so one thing I will say is that one of the gifts of the organization that is my day job at the Queer Cultural Center is they let me say whatever I want uncensored. Okay, so I want to say that is a gift. So when I say what I'm about to say with a challenge, keep that in mind. All right, so what happened was, all right, so Queer Cultural Center, it's based in San Francisco. Yes, we do the National Queer Arts Festival. It's about 50 events in 30 days in and around June. We also have the National Queer Performing Arts Summit, which is this massive, it's a huge thing. So Performing Arts Present, it's a partnership with the National Performance Network and all these other groups. And within that, in the programs, like, I am one of three people deciding who is going to be presented on these stages. So that is a lot. And this organization. And what I love is the artistic director of the Queer Cultural Center is one of the first people I came out to. I'm in the beginning of a coming out process and a gender transition. And so when I started to talk about centering trans women of color and trans femmes of color in this work, I knew the people I could talk to and trust to hold that. And when I say centering, I'm talking about, I don't want to program, I don't want to have like, you know, five slots and be like, okay, well these five slots are going to be the trans women of color, you know, like that kind of thing, right? Like that's not exactly what I'm interested in. What I'm interested in is work that actually talks, that isn't just talking about us, or that isn't just us pigeonholing us. I want us to have the power to claim our space and our agency. So the good news around that challenge is there is some, we've built a lot of trust in the organization, and there are some staffing changes that are coming with that. And what I have to keep in mind with that is like pushing it, like keeping in mind and really rooted with my sisters and about like what is the agenda we want to have. And so I'm excited about what's going to happen next, and I can't say publicly. I said I was at the beginning of the coming out process, and I realized we are live streaming on HowlRound, so hi. Alrighty.
Realty. No, oh no, no, you got two full minutes.
Oh my land.
All right, I was just giving you silent support.
Thank you. So I can't talk about the Queer Cultural Center without talking about Peacock Rebellion, which, you know, I'm the executive director and artistic director, and we have a show on Friday. Of course, I'm going to come here and schlock my wares. So we run a training program by and for queer and trans people of color. We use comedy for social justice, and it is a partnership, is because we know that culture moves politics. And when I talk about power, this is going to be the debut, the comedy debut of Miss Major Griffin Gracie. She's 75. Okay, it's going to be the comedy debut of Cece McDonald, right? It is going to be Janetta Johnson, who is the executive director of the TGI Justice Project. It's a partnership with TGI Justice Project, Ella para Trans Latinas, CUAV, QuacMap, Queer Women of Color Media Arts Project. There are a lot of us who are coming together, and it is rooted in our work. So when I'm talking about power, what I'm talking about is we are not only taking a stage, we are pushing the campaign work forward. That is what we were trying to do. So we have a mic, and we happen to be sexy right now. And so while we do that, what we were able to do with our base, with our fan base, is get people into the court. We helped pack a courtroom last week for a bail hearing for Precious, who's a member of TGI Justice Project. That is our agenda. So housing, right? We have an opportunity in Oakland. This is a secret, so I'm going to tell you on HowlRound. This is a secret. We have an opportunity, and we now have an office in East Oakland. So when we're talking about the work and rooting this, okay, we are building an artist in residence program where trans women of color coming out of prison actually have housing and are building an artist in residence program. Okay? So yes, I'm doing that with Peacock Rebellion and the challenge. It's like mostly on my credit card, real. It's mostly on my. Okay. So, but a Queer Cultural Center is fiscally sponsoring us, has pushed as many resources as they can to us. But it is to be led by trans women of color and trans femmes of color, and to be doing this work. And the ways we leak secret discount codes for tickets, we have for certain communities and community-based organizations. We give 100 comp tickets for each show. This Friday we'll have 800 people coming and seeing this stuff. So, and the 7 p.m. show sold out, but there's 10 p.m. Anyway, so talk to me about that later, but in terms of the challenges with that too, it's like in the last week, I had, one of my friends died. 2 weeks before that, another person I love died. So challenges are also like when we're working with artists, I'm having these conversations about like people are keep talking to me about artistic excellence, like this is going around, right? This like the presenting our organizations in the U.S. A lot of these folks are using artistic excellence. We need to talk about artistic excellence. And for me, there's nothing artistically excellent about the status quo that is boring to me. Okay, so I say okay a lot. I'm noticing this. So when we talk about artistic excellence, I think recentering and getting and taking stages and having things like this, like that is artistic excellence. show is in three languages. That is a lot of prep work. It isn't something tacked on to the end. I am neurodiverse. I am multiply disabled. So there's a lot of work that we have to do to recognize ourselves and each other as whole, full people coming in and sharing our craft, and community engagement as a hell of a lot more than selling tickets to an underserved community. Mm-hmm. It's about a complete shift in the ways that we are making and claiming our artistic and cultural practices. And it's about taking those back because they have been around for a lot longer than the nonprofit industrial complex.
Work! Yes, for that 5 minutes.
I know, thanks.
Yes!
All that 5 minutes. All right, and rounding it out, Ty Defoe, go ahead.
All right, thank you. And just to thank the panelists, everything that everyone said was just really resonating, the successes and challenges and a list of challenges and a list of successes. What I want to talk about, I think, today a little bit is about decolonizing. I was thinking about decolonizing the theater and stories, education, language, and especially decolonizing the mind. We live in this world, I think, I'm coming from and speaking about an indigenous background of using shared leadership models that talks about the circle of life. And to me, that's really about art making, about making theater. It's about reevaluating what we place upon value within the theater system, on the stages, within our theater. I think that's really important, as well as our circle of funding and where that comes from. And I think, the goalless goal is that we achieve that through this great circle. There's a personal story I want to share, actually, because I do lots of different types of theater. And I was like, wow, the theater is really interesting, because I'm like, well, where's my space in the American theater if I'm a two-spirit, trans-identified, indigenous person? I'm like, when I deal with lots of circles, and I come from a hoop dance, and we dance in circles, and we tell stories in circles, and I have to go to the American theater that's built in a square, how am I going to fit my circle into that square? Right. So those are some things I think about. A story goes about this, about bringing theater to actual communities. And I had this really personal moment about creating art within a community and being out back home where things are colonized today in a contemporary society. And me across from a buffet, in Wisconsin, having a salad and I think like veggie pork roast tacos or something, and the community showed up, and there was this older female across from me, and I came back after years, to do work in the community, and this woman didn't recognize me. She thought I was my brother, and we were talking, and she was about, 65 plus, and I was like, oh, Lord, I don't have the time to really go in and to explain what is happening here, because this person went through a boarding school era where they weren't able to sort of talk about their sexual identity as well as their gender, and then, you know what, I was like, no, I'm going to take the time out right now and discuss this with this woman. And so as we got talking, she gave me a hug and she had tears in her eyes. And she was saying that she's like, I've always wanted to make a kastowe. And a kastowe is the hat that we wear in a Haudenosaunee Nation, Iroquois Nation, that usually, quote unquote, men wear. And she was like, I'm gonna do that dance. I'm gonna do this. So, we went back with community engagement, and sure enough, she was out there in the in our circle, and she was wearing that kastowe, and you could tell she was really working on herself, and she just never had the chance to self-identify, to create art. So that's a personal touch and success I wanted to share. The other thing I want to talk about, too, is about shared leadership, which I'm a huge fan of. And I have a social justice background, as well as I feel like it's so interesting saying that that is social justice, because that is my everyday life, existing with all of you here and showing up with your body in space and time as an act of social justice. So I think that's really important to sort of, decolonize our bodies and our language about where we are. So I think the idea is to, activate everyone to do that, especially people in these leadership positions. I think it's really important. It's like, well, you have to have a look at it from the inside, outside, and from all perspectives, right? That circle is not a flat surface. That circle is a sphere, right? You look at it from all angles, and if we could try to make something like that, I think we could have some kind of, you know, a measure of value or success. What else? The other thing I wanted to talk about right? There are these set standards of values. Well, who's making those values, right? Who's putting that measure of success upon us, right? We can reclaim and reinvent. I think like language, if we decolonize it, it's constantly evolving. And that's something that's really important through administrative support. You know, there are times where so many challenges I could name right now where you take something just as simple as a name, right? A name. Something as simple as asking someone, right? The person sitting next to you right now, maybe, right? These small things showing up in a room are really important. So I want to introduce something about we-volving, right? We're evolving, but can we evolve together? So.
Yes. Great. Before I open it up just for discussion, I want to name that we have maybe like 10, 15 minutes to chat. And I'm going to say that after this, we have breakout sessions. And in those breakout sessions, I feel like there will be space for the audience to process some of what you heard right now. But for this remaining 10, 15, let's just keep it with the panel. Cool. Does anyone here want to respond to anything that they heard? I'm happy to recap. I was taking copious notes. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I would say, I think the interesting part about this setup, though, going off of Ty, right?
Yeah.
Your last comment about the circle and the square, I always think about spatial arrangements, that I'm interested in the space here, right? Like right now, because this is a very interesting position to be in, because one, we're live streaming. Two, so, you know, the idea of these eyeballs, these, like, people who are present but not present in the room, so there's, like, right. This sort of expectation. And then there's an audience, so I naturally want to engage with the eyes that are directly in front of me, and it's, like, I just want to say that it's, like, a sort of a driving force and sort of consciousness I have as I'm speaking, that there's people who aren't speaking that are in dialogue with us, although that we're, like, in this little cove over here on stage. Yeah. So I'm a little lost for words because I'm, like, hey, people. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Totally. Do other folks have initial responses?
Yeah, I guess I have one thing to say about that, too. It's sort of like, right, like people on this Howl live stream round, it's like constantly asking yourself, who is not in the room, right? If you're even identify as being trans or maybe you're stealth or something like this, right? It's like, well, who isn't here? Like, who is not at the table? Who's not at the circle? So, you know, to sort of quote Carmen Morgan from Art Equity about, like, intention is everything. Right, our intentions, and trying to keep it at the forefront, in the mind's eye. Who is not in the room, and who do we need to bring to the table? So,
another quote of Carmen Morgan that I was thinking about mentioning is that, you know, some of what I'm hearing here from a couple people's stories is about tending to other people's comforts. And, you know, something that Carmen says a lot is that the conversation should not be dictated by the discomfort of the people in the room with the most privilege. And I think that's worth repeating, right? The conversation should not be dictated by the comfort level of the people with the most privilege, sort of in the conversation in the room.
But I feel like it takes also like a ferocious, sort of rageful, like confidence to actually embody that quote, right? Like I was saying to someone who's driving me here, who's talking about experiences of violence that they've had working with theaters in the Bay Area, and I was talking about my experience in Chicago. We did not name the theaters once to each other, right? Mm-hmm. And we both said we would really love to write pieces, so we're also channeling our rage and our anger into this sort of like super professional format. Mm-hmm. And then even that, we were like, we're not sure. Mm-hmm. We want to wait until we have positions of power so that we are not in harm's way by being honest, right, about our situations. Hence, going to what you said, you work at a place that lets you say whatever you want to say. So I think there's also like a sort of, like, I feel like in the arts, people love the sort of, like, courageous, bad person who, like, just says what they want and just, like, on top of everything. But for me, I'm like, if I actually did that every day, I wouldn't have a career. You know, like, I would not be working with anyone if I actually said, like, this is unacceptable, mm-hmm. like, and not managed it in ways that I feel like oppressed people are taught to manage their rage and their frustration in situations. Mm-hmm. It's like I've had to really take on a sort of, like, silent patience. Extreme devastation that was happening to him and his people, and the sort of ways in which I feel the need to connect to people like that in this day and age, because people believe that somehow we're past the issues that we're dealing with, but in so many ways it's so present that it's like such a mind game that you have to play, right, where you're trying to convince people who believe that something doesn't exist and that you're standing right in front of them experiencing it.
Yeah. But I just also want to speak to, I think, something that I thought about in preparing for this. It's a tremendous burden to put on the other person, the person who is trans or the person that is not like everyone else, to change the minds of the world. So it takes a tremendous amount of courage, but it's also you need to be mindful and realistic about the energy you share in telling your full story. So sometimes it's just too much for one person to be the gender non-conforming face of any organization. That being said, I think there's so many practices that can happen, and I think that are being attempted to happen, that provide the certainty that an institution can be an ally, even if not understanding exactly what that means in the moment, to try to promote true diversity. So I guess what this thought came to my mind was, in some of my experiences with donors and me being, I don't want to make them uncomfortable. Well, in the long run, my self-advocacy and my authenticity is necessary for this theater more than one gift to a campaign or one support of a show. So I think as institutions evolve in this world that we have that is much more nuanced and becoming more dynamic about identity and intersectionality, there needs to be a partnership between the individual that is not conforming and the organization to see how together it can be a joint effort for mutual understanding. So, and I think that's possible. Like the Exploratorium did a It Gets Better video, which is something that I don't think a lot of local arts organizations do, right? So this was self-promoted by the staff and completely funded by the organization as a, yes, we hear you and we want to support this. You're not on your own for explaining the malleability of or the acceptance of this culture.
Yeah, I think also something that I've experienced, because I've worked for theaters a lot, aside from like working in theaters as an artist. Also, like when doing outreach and when trying to build one's audience, and then trying to maintain like a very archaic donor base for the most part, it's like, why do we see those things as separate? Like maybe the audiences that you're trying to tap into is the new donor base. Maybe like if you stop coddling this archaic donor base that like is holding you back from, say, making the work that you tell artists and tell your programmers you want to make, like it's like changing the circle, like changing the square into a circle, right? Mm-hmm. Seeing like maybe our problem is that our model doesn't work. Maybe we need to start thinking about how the community we want to get into the theater can fund the theater from both ticket sales or maybe not ticket sales. Maybe we become a free theater, but they're going to be funding us in a different sort of membership model, whatever, right? This is the sort of things that I would you know, say all the time in the theaters that I worked for, and they weren't interested, right? Because it's a shifting of power. It's a shifting not from like a singular internship position or through strategic planning and like continuing the same archaic sort of modes of operation. It's like, how do we really think about the work we want to make in the communities we want to impact truly, right? And I want to say impact by changing the dire and urgent needs of those communities. Like, I'm sorry, as a black person growing up in the Bronx, I wasn't necessarily interested in Shakespeare in the Park. You know what I mean? Like, that wasn't what I was interested at that point in my life. Now, yes, sometimes I may go, but I think, you know, there are conversations about what communities need and how art can serve several different purposes, and that's why there's a plethora of theaters. But when everyone's trying to replicate theater in the Park, where is there room for arts organizations to speak to my experience that I had when I was growing up?
I think we have room for maybe one more comment, and then I will wrap up the panel and take us into the next section if anyone wants to name it.
Happen. You know, I think just to like reemphasize about shifting paradigm and like reevaluating our models, I mean, you know, yeah, it's hard being like the trans like person of color that's speaking. So I think what you can do as an ally to each other is really like asking yourself those questions, like who isn't at the table. You can also, I think this should also, if you're a leader in your community, educate yourself is like one way, you know. I think creating brown bags, I know when I was at TCG as a fellow, we did educational brown bags where we did shared leadership models where it can, you know, that person in the, who is doing most of the administrative supportive was like, you know, on it and then eventually running brown bags and then can go into the community, right? So you think about creating something that is echoing as a response to art, but also as echoing a response to some kind of, you know, like show business sort of thing that's happening. How do these things dialogue and talk to each other? So I think there are small ways that you can, you know, do community engagement as well as inform each other. And I just like want to underscore education, education, education. And for all of you who need an ally, like I'm there to support, you know, trans women of color. Like that's something that I don't know too much about. Like I do everything in my power to sort of, you know, ask and uplift those folks who are in real life facing the reality of death, so.
Yeah. I feel like, Manish, you're the only one who didn't get to add another comment, so I want to make space for that, too. You're cool?
Yeah, I'm good.
You good? Okay, cool. Yes, I just want to name a couple things. I'm going to echo some things that came up for us, and then we'll move into some breakout sessions. But, you know, I want to say that I really feel and appreciate everything that people have been mentioning up here. We, in one of the artists that Lisa and I were engaging with to not be on this panel, but to engage in the day, you know, asked us, like, can I speak my truth? Like, can I come here and actually be real about my situation, or am I gonna get listed as like not wanting to be worked with, right? And it was something we talked about a lot, right? Because we wanna be like, yes, please, speak your truth. This is the space for this. But we also can't control, you know, what people's experience is gonna be as well. So it's like this, it's like that negotiation, you know what I mean? And I just wanna name that, that that's something like, present here, you know, if folks are feeling challenged or uncomfortable by these thoughts, you know, the question is, why do I feel that way, right? Maybe not necessarily like turning it back up here. But so I just want to name that. And then another thing, just these sort of institutional transformations or paradigm shifts that we're talking about, I find that something that I encounter a lot is like when I push for that, for shared power, for shared leadership. And I feel like it's been brought up in so many like sort of different perspectives on this panel. You know, a response that I get often is like sort of this free-loving collective that, you know, like won't be sustainable or something like that. And it's not a binary, right? It's not one thing or the other. It's a process, right? Sharing leadership and moving forward is a process. And so what we've heard are like some immediate institutional strategies that you can do to lessen the harm, right, that trans-identified folks experience. There's a lot of self-education about social location, right, and your sort of own privilege and where you're coming from, especially as a leader. And then there's a lot of collaborative stuff as well, right? Working with people in relationship. I'm just gonna lift up a couple things that I heard during this panel. Names, sort of this idea of tending to other people's comfort, and not, you know, that being a challenge. Reframing community engagements to see, you know, to move away from this sort of like selling tickets place, more, you know, not this like transactional relationship, right? We had we-volving as a sort of shared model for evolving values, challenging ideas of artistic excellence and what that means, building power with, recentering, this idea that culture moves politics, decolonizing, too. Great. I would also ask, like, is there anything else that came in this discussion that y'all just want to name? Something that's sitting with you right now. Yeah. Go ahead.
I mean, I just want to say that, again, I think reframing the model and finding a new way to support our art form that goes beyond what is traditional is definitely necessary, but I think there is also an opportunity, specifically in this moment in time in our country, in political system and what's happening right now, to educate those that do have resources, that do support the theater as they do right now, to tell we should have some faith and attempts to recognize the generosity of spirit of people that can make that happen now.
It's interesting because I was going to say something that's in direct conflict. I feel like from people who I've talked to as a younger person, I'm like, yeah, it's, you know, blah, blah, blah. And they're like, yeah, we've been doing this since the 60s. We've been doing this since the 70s. So I say, if we wait for the girls to decide to step down from their positions of power and we wait for the girls to be more educated than they were in 1975, we'll be waiting until we're, right, like 75 years old. Yeah. So I'm no longer interested in waiting for people in positions of power to do anything. I think it's really about taking power, creating spaces, and relocating the funds. I'm really interested in who's interested in continuing to give these girls the money and figuring out ways to build centers for people who need housing and who are artists and who want to make work and tell their truth, and how those movements can be directly related to creating equity, right, and creating justice for people, because I see art as a way to also change the current political system. So yes, that is what I would like to say and end it with. There's sacrifices that need to be made. Not everyone is going to be happy, right? There are lots of people who are very unhappy right now, which is why we're on this panel. So saying that, it's like we need to understand that sacrifices are going to have to be made. Sadly, I've had to sacrifice every time I've had to leave a job that was racist, homophobic, or transphobic. So maybe you need to sacrifice by taking a break, doing the education, and starting over. And I think that is a radical thing to say, but very simple.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Anything you two want to lift up from the conversation?
Yeah, I just want to say, too, that, you know, I think I totally agree with this statement, too. And then there's those folks, you know, that just have lots of privilege, lots of power. And power is, like, a really tricky thing, because I think, like, giving that up power or having that change is really uncomfortable. And I just want to let those, if you're sitting in this room or if you're on the live television, that it's going to be uncomfortable. You're going to get a little sweaty. It's going to feel like, ooh, you know, it's not going to feel good. But I guess, like, I want to uplift this with this too, as the world's changing, and it will. We're already seeing this in universities across the country where, you know, I just came from the American Institute of the Arts, where all of my students went by they. No one had a he or she pronoun. So having conversations on a daily experience, like, I really got to work my muscle, I think, of calling by everyone by their name or by they. But to get into circles of education, there are, you know, white folks who are doing this work, to learning about people of color, color, and they're also learning about gender justice, and I think that's important. And it's okay to have like an education buddy, right? It's just like, it's come on, the world is changing. So I just want to encourage folks who are, you know, I don't want you to get left behind.
Yeah, and I just also want to say, I think it's coming from both angles, right? The solution is both to blow up the system and then to do what we can to use the resources we have to change the system, because I think it will come at a meeting in the middle. So
very true. Any last words from Manish?
Okay, yeah, so I have examples of how we've done that. Try to, you know, and so one of the things, for example, is, you know, we have a fundraising team of white folks. One separate team that gets very little resources and time from me. Okay. And what they do is they are, I would say, politically radical white folks who specifically raise money for us from other white people. And they have the conversations, right? They have the conversations that I am out of, like, you know, I have the white folks, I can be like, I am fresh out of fucks to give you all. Like, I do not have time. I don't have time because I'm dealing with this police brutality issue. You know, like, there's, yeah, like, real shit, mm-hmm, going on. Mm-hmm. So I have the white, you know, the people I trust, the people who have built relationships with me in the Bay Area for, you know, for a decade or more, who I can call on to handle their folks, right, to have those conversations. Mm-hmm. And there's the work that I'm doing, you know, and that kind of thing. And so that's I think, one way. And then in terms of the individual donor piece, I happen to have come out of both sex work and individual donor fundraising, which is sex work with clothes on. And so sometimes not.
Tricky.
You know, and I do think that there's a thing, yeah, fundraising is sex work. And so, and I think that, and the, it's just, it is. You know, and I think the thing is that,
hashtag,
like, yes, I want folks to feel good about the power, and I don't think it's actually about anyone giving up power. Like, I think what I've, the conversations that I've heard, to actually be able to come back and that's what I want. Collective liberation. Everybody wins. And so that is what I am invested in. Thanks.
Yes. What a beautiful note to end on. Yeah, I was. I just want to share, Nick and I were talking the other day, and they said something really beautiful that I would love to share as well, which is just like, in the future, we are, you know, it is only going to benefit us to think more expansively. In the future, we are not going to think back and think like, dang, I wish we would have been more rigid about that, or I wish we would have categorized people more, you know, or whatever, right? Like, expansivity, new word, is only going to serve us. Mm-hmm. So, thank you so much to our panelists for speaking such beautiful and real thoughts, sentiments into this space. We're going to transition into some breakout sessions. And these sessions, you know, Lisa and Tirza are going to be facilitating a session in this room for folks who do not identify on a trans spectrum in any kind of way. So for cisgender folks, we'll be in this room. And then there's another rehearsal room, like kitty corner here. And Jack Victor, who's standing in the back over there, and myself will be co-facilitating that space. And then we'll come back together at 5. Is there anything else I need to say about that, Lisa?
Oh, anything else?
Oh, well, yeah, whatever. yeah, I think that's it.
Lisa,
that's it.
Do you mind taking a picture?
Yes. Okay. So for folks on HowlRound who are watching, we are going to be talking about strategies specifically in these breakout sessions and also processing some of what came up on the panel. If you'd like to contribute, hashtag breaking the binary 2016. Yeah, and we'll see everyone back here at 5. Oh, we've got a question. Go for it.
Just explain on the division of the rooms, like, so if you're a lesbian cisgender person, like me, you go with the cis people and not with the trans people? Or?
Correct, yes. We are specifically... yeah, I mean, that's a great question, right? Like, you know, this sort of queer community umbrella, as including, you know, both sexuality and gender representations, right? There's a lot of overlap there, and I think historically, it's been used for political movements as just one big thing. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, intersectionality is key, right? Like, different parts of our identities hold different places of power and different, you know, experience different oppressions, right, all at once, right? So for the purpose of this breakout, if you identify on some sort of trans spectrum, you'll be in that room. And if you identify as cisgender, you'll be in this room. Yeah. And that... No. We are specifically focusing on...
Gender, not sexuality.
Gender, not sexuality. Yes. And also, yeah, there's nothing, no negativity against yeah. You know.
Because there may be lots of trans lesbians in the other room. So,
you know, we never know.
True.
Yeah. You never know.
And we'll be back in an hour sharing out what we talked about. All is good. Thank you so much. We'll take a moment to transition. Cheers. Woo.